Mrs. E descended.
Don't know how I got out of bed this morning. I had it all down one side. I put my foot down. God, it was like plugging into the mains. It shot right up and I came over all giddy. I thought, oh no, I'm going. And it started swimming my life before me. Oh, I smell the lilies. I had such a good cry. It was lovely. I just wanted to lay back. So I can't really recline. It's put me on tablets, but it's a constant fight to relax. Sunday last, I was hitting a drop of liniment. Just bent down to pull up my surgical stockings. Went all slipped out again. Busy, well, didn't have time to straighten up. I can't sleep. Not since Mr. E passed over. It's like giving your leg off. You think it's still there in the bed. I mean, it was 33 years last Tuesday. I just got used to his snoring and mornings he'd make me a herbal infusion I used to love doing for him. Oh!
Darning socks, store your man. Darn, 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 big toaster again. Darn, oh, never mind, I'll start again. No, no, really, I will. Darning socks for your man. Darn, 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 big toaster again. Darning socks, darn, darn, darn. Darn, there goes the door, knocker up, and it's Mrs. Brown. Hello, dear, come inside, have a cup of tea. I hope I'm not intruding, you know me. Give you time to boil it, may I use your toilet? Looking round, can I help anything at all? Ooh, matter of fact, come to think, I got a lot of socks to darn. Never mind the stinky stink. Me husband, he's out farming. Farm, farm, farm. Says he a bit of muck. Never do folks any harm. Out in his gum boots. Plow, plow, plow. Muggins here has got to feed his big fat sow. He tried it on this morning. The sauce is so-and-so. Get your breakfast down, you and out you go. Just one little bit of nog. Shit, I'll go again. And mountains go, keep going, yeah. Just one bit of comfort core. I lie inside me box. If the Lord wears trousers, the prophets never mention socks. And should an angel ask me for a little older fill? Well, dear, darn, 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 I'll go to well.
On Sensible Common, Hubert Rawlinson, in his mid-40s and still unusual, with his adventurous young nephew, Rafe, are playing cricket. During a break, Hubert, his friend Reg Smeaton and the rest of the team enjoy a chilled glass of paraffino in the shade of the pavilion. But Rafe has determined he will rid the club of moles. Hubert polished his trident with a sleeve of the white pullover carelessly wrapped around his waist.
"You could see everything from the top of that bus," he said sadly. "We were in Regent Street and I was looking right into Brainwashing House. I could see them all running around inside, catching diseases and giggling. My father leant across to me and said, 'You'll be in there if you don't stop playing with yourself.' He died of chrysanthemum poisoning. They had to kill all his plants. You know, he was the real author of A Pictorial History of Gargling. A very great work."
Mr. Smeaton froze like a red setter. His conversation of the "you speak, I wait, you pause, I pounce" variety lent exaggerated ear.
"They strapped a bloom to his back and it came up all blotchy. That's why he drank. It was brasso mostly."
Hubert struck an odd heroic pose. Smeaton twitched and stared up. Hubert, although himself Karloff soft-spoken, liked to hear other people shouting. This he considered not only healthful, but just might, if taken to its illogical conclusion, do away with telephones. Thus, it was not only for speed, stature, and far-seeing that habitually he went on stilts, for also he affected an ear trumpet, with the consequence that confidants stood on boxes or tiptoe or jumped up and up to converse with him. Hubert all time straining, craning, cupping his good ear, feigning non comprendi, and muttering, "Pardon? Come again? Do speak upwards," and etc., at the same time shaking uncontrollably, giggling as his hapless companion empurpled and shrieked. Reg Smeaton said,
"Did you know there is no proper name for the back of the knees?"
Hubert gestured with his trident. "Look, there's Rafe," he said with rare insight.
With practiced effort, Mr. Smeaton behaved outwardly as he knew he must and screwed his eyes Hong Kong to the distant figure, microscopic and lifelike, shimmering on the pitch.
"He boiled roly-poly puddings in old socks," said Hubert dreamily.
Hubert was unusual. In his adolescence, during the summer, in a northerly direction parallel to the earthly axis, he would throw himself naked onto the lawn, and with that loathsome bluey Roman clock face tattooed about his private parts, think about Jean Harlow very hard, and from the shadow cast, tell the time with remarkable accuracy.
"Look, no hands, Auntie,"
he would screech. In the winter, he tried with birthday candles stuck in the end. Was hours slow, and Henry told him to put a sock on the sundial bit. And so he contented himself by waiting sentry in the hall and inviting visitors to stand on his feet. He would then give their weight in a dreadful monotone and present them with cigarette cards depicting early flying machines or steam engines. P.C. Gibbon, the long arm of the law, arrested him a few times, but now conceded he was harmless.
The poor man got